So we're getting into respiratory viral season. So this is a very timely topic, and use the catchy title, "It's only a virus," or maybe I should have said it's just a virus, since that that terminology is in our lexicon. And yeah, us as adults, and then either if we have kids at home or the patients that we see, we're going to see viral infections. We all get colds in the wintertime. And 90% of the time, 99% of the time, it's bothersome, but not a big problem. But sometimes it can be a really big problem. So kind of a high level overview of viral infections, but first with an actual case study, we'll talk about some different viral infections. And then after my 10 to 15 minutes, we can open this up to questions. So this is an actual case that is in our pediatric ICU right now. So not a child that's underlying normal, so she has some issues, but fairly illustrative of what can happen. So she's an 11-month-old that has hypotonia. We really don't have a firm diagnosis for her. She has a weak cough, developmental delay. She presented with cough and rapid breathing. She was here previously with an episode of rhinovirus that had superimposed pneumonia and required intubation. So when she presented, she was afebrile, but she was tachycardic with a heart rate of 174. She was tachypneic with a respiratory rate of 63 breaths per minute. And on exam, she was tachypneic, she was belly breathing, and she had crackles on exam of her chest. Her oxygen saturation was 78% on room air. So a nasal swab was done to look for influenza and RSV. Influenza rapid tests were negative, but the RSV test was positive. So this helped to explain why she was sick. And here's her initial chest x-ray. She's got a little bit of airspace disease outside of the heart, but overall it doesn't look too bad. On her venous blood gas, she had a pH of 7.31. at PCO2 of 45, so not looking too terribly bad. But despite being on BiPAP, she continued to be tachypneic and tachycardic, and she needed to be intubated. So here she is on an x-ray where she's intubated, and now you can see that her lungs look worse than the previous x-ray. I don't know if my pointer will show up here remotely. Okay, so she's got some airspace disease up here in the right upper lobe, or right middle lobe outside the heart border. That's a little bit opacified also. She was intubated probably about a week ago, and in fact is still intubated, and still has a very tenuous status. So we are getting into RSV and influenza season. So all sorts of respiratory viruses, RSV, which we'll talk about later, rhinovirus is the common cold virus. Human metapneumovirus has been described more over the last probably 15 to 20 years. Influenza has been around forever. And in fact, this is the 100-year anniversary of the Spanish flu pandemic that killed millions of people around the world. As an aside, and I don't know how many people have extra time on their hands, but 1 week ago today, we had a pediatric grand rounds on influenza, and our guest speaker was an infectious disease doctor from Vanderbilt. If you go to videos.med.wisc.edu and look for pediatric grand rounds, you can see her video. One of the interesting statistics that she gave a week ago today was that there are about 100 pediatric deaths per year due to influenza in this country. That's the average. So influenza, it certainly can be serious. Adenovirus and parainfluenza virus. So we saw with the case that she had a rapid test done in which we learned that she had rhinovirus. That was positive. The influenza was negative. And I think probably all facilities these days have the capability of rapid testing. The question is, should you do that? We'll talk about this a little bit later when I'll be talking about bronchiolitis guidelines. Generally, I would think in the emergency department, if it's pretty clear cut, it's a child with bronchiolitis, really don't need to do any testing. And bronchiolitis is not always precipitated by RSV. Certainly these other viruses here on the screen can cause bronchiolitis, but RSV is one of the more common ones. We sometimes have kids in the hospital that are sick, and we want to know what is causing them to be sick. So we do have access here at UW, and I'm sure probably most other places do, to do a respiratory viral panel. And this is what it looks like. I know, and I realize it's a little bit small here on the screen, but this is what it looks like on our Epic medical record as the results. And this is a different patient, so not this patient, but this is a patient that was rhinovirus positive. So they've got it highlighted in yellow with an exclamation point, with the reference range being negative for all these other viruses. And then there's a few things on here that are not viral infections. So Bordetella pertussis is also in a respiratory viral panel. The turnaround time for this in our institution is about 1 to 2 days. Whereas I know the rapid influenza and RSV, you can get back within maybe 15 to 30 minutes, depending on your institution and how quick they are to turn around things. But yeah, I certainly see a skewed population like this patient in the hospital right now that is admitted and sick. Most patients with bronchiolitis can be sent home from the emergency department. But I see the tip of the iceberg. I see the worst of the worst. So specifically talk about RSV, since it's so very common and we're going to be getting into the peak of that here soon. It causes 40 to 50% of hospitalizations due to accounts for those cases of bronchiolitis. 25% of hospitalizations in pediatrics cause pneumonia. And these are old statistics. This actually may be even inflated more because I put these slides together probably a good 15 years ago. 100,000 admissions annually costing $300 million. This is probably increased these days with inflation. So paramyxovirus is the general family, the overall family has three genera in it. So there's paramyxovirus, which includes parainfluenza viruses 1 through 4 and the mumps virus. Pneumovirus, which is the virus that RSV belongs to, the subspecies. And then morbillivirus, which is, I have a mistake on this slide. I just realized I've got mumps in two different categories, mumps and rubeola. So I have a mistake on this slide, and I don't know which is correct. So I apologize for that mistake. And then there's a schematic of viral proteins, how viruses are packaged on this slide. Getting specifically to RSV, so it causes syncytia formation in tissue culture cells. There's a fusion glycoprotein that confers the ability to fuse cell membranes with the formation of intracellular bridges and ultimately multinucleated cells, which is syncytia. So on this microscopic slide, these pink areas are fused cells. So that's what syncytia are, and that's how this got the name respiratory syncytial virus. So RSV epidemiology, in this part of the country, it's usually November through April. Interestingly, if you live in Florida, they have RSV almost year round due to their climate. So that's pretty interesting that it's different in Florida compared to other parts of the country. Affects all ages, infants 6 weeks to 2 years of age are most susceptible. And by 2 to 3 years of age, all children have probably had at least one case of RSV. Most of those will be just regular colds, as we'll see here in a moment. They can be kept at home. They don't come to medical attention because the parent just thinks, well, my child has a runny nose, they have a cold. Attack rates of 50 to 95% of previously uninfected infants, and we get infected with this recurrently throughout our life. It's highly, highly contagious. I think the modes of transmission is up to debate. I had some slides in this presentation, which I took out. There was a study done quite some time ago in which they had babies with RSV in the hospital, and they had caretakers go into the room, and they divided them into three groups. They had the touchers, the cuddlers, and the sitters. So the the cuddlers would actually hold the baby, change their diaper, actually interact with the baby. The touchers would touch the rails of the crib and the bedside table, but would not actually touch the baby. And then the sitters would sit in a room reading a book or a newspaper, but not touching anything. And they looked at the infections in these patients, in the adults who volunteered for this study. And the touchers and the cuddlers got RSV, but the sitters did not. So they concluded from the study that this is not spread by small particle aerosol. I don't believe that. I mean, our procedure here is that a patient with RSV is in respiratory isolation, and all caregivers going into the room wear gowns, gloves, and masks. And I would definitely want to wear a mask to go into a room. I remember a while ago, another hospital in the city took that article to heart, and their isolation procedures for kids with RSV were gowns and gloves only with no masks. And I would not want to go into a room with a child with RSV without wearing a mask, because I don't want to get it. I mean, it's so highly, highly contagious. I wonder if that study that was published was flawed. So editorial opinion on editorial comment from me on that. So primary RSV infection, about 1% of patients can be asymptomatic. The vast, vast, vast majority have upper respiratory tract infection symptoms only, 69%. They've got a runny nose. 30% have a lower respiratory tract infection or illness, I should say. A hospitalization rate of 0.5 to 2%. Younger babies can present with apnea. So that's a very common presentation. They can have apnea. And then there is a mortality with RSV, just like there is with influenza. It's fairly low, but there certainly can be babies that die due to RSV. So what happens in the lungs is you get necrosis of the respiratory epithelium, regeneration of non-ciliated epithelial cells, obstruction of the airways by secretions, a lymphocytic parabronchiolar infiltrate, and submucosal and interstitial edema. So the presentation, profuse rhinorrhea followed by a cough, reduced feeding, fevers low grade or absent, tachypnea, plus or minus cyanosis, retractions, wheezing, or crackles. So treatment is the most challenging thing about this, because all sorts of treatments have been tried in the past. Inhaled bronchodilators, steroids, ribavirin. When I was a resident in the 80s, ribavirin was very much in vogue. But after the initial study was done that showed that there was an improvement, the actual measurement scale of the improvement was questioned. And ribavirin is really not used now except for immunocompromised hosts. Nebulized hypertonic saline was somewhat in vogue in the last few years, but this is an article I have in kind of a purple font here in the bottom of a multi-center randomized trial recently that showed that nebulized hypertonic saline is not helpful either. So the bottom line is the treatment is hydration. You can certainly use saline nose drops and suction the nose as needed. If patients need oxygen, then obviously they need to be in the hospital for that. And it's really just mostly symptomatic treatment and tincture of time for patients to get over RSV bronchiolitis and for viral infections in general. I guess the one exception, which was highlighted in the pediatric grand rounds 1 week ago on influenza, was antiviral medications for influenza. I think I'm gonna butcher the name of the drug because I know the brand name better, Tamiflu or Osol. I can't even remember the name of it. Oseltamivir.
That's for sure.
Yeah, Tamiflu is easier to say. So that's certainly useful.
They did the right thing. They made it impossible to say the generic.
That's certainly useful to be, for patients with influenza. Our state lab of hygiene will publish data on influenza activity in the state. I know this is hard to read since I have it just on the right side of the screen. So just zooming in, to the bottom left on this. I just received this in my email 3 days ago. You can see it's dated December 17th. This is activity ending as of December 8th. So rhinovirus, enterovirus, 12.9% positive. So there are surveillance sites around the state, which is where this data comes from. And the down arrow means that the prevalence of this is decreasing. RSV, 8.3%. Its prevalence is increasing. Parainfluenza virus is coming down. That makes sense because parainfluenza virus we see more in the fall. Adenovirus is increasing. Influenza is only 1.3%, but we're not going to get to the peak of that soon. And probably in the next few weeks, the next time or the time after when the State Lab of Hygiene comes out with this report, we'll probably start to see an up arrow. Human metapneumovirus, 1.1%. Coronavirus, and then they've got a non-viral infection down here, pertussis, at the very bottom. So you can go to the State Lab of Hygiene website and find this report. It's hard to see on the screen, but in this graph here, this is positive for influenza by PCR in Wisconsin, and it's too hard to read this.